the City of Destiny and our online services. I'm Jonathan Cain, and we'd like to welcome you to worship. We invite you to pray with us, spend some time in fellowship and prayer, and receive a word from my lovely wife, Pastor Paula White Cain, who has an anointed message, a special message tonight. So wherever you are out there, we ask you to consider a divine pause. Just hit the relax button. And those of you that have been afflicted with this illness, and those of you that have survived this illness, this virus, this warfare, the song is for you, because we are blessed to be set apart, to be healed by the Father, the only healer, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm a survivor. Come on. So long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stones on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace, but you came and showed me the way. When I was a lost soul searching, you were the ground beneath my feet. When I was a blind man begging, you were the eyes who I could see. When the smoke was rising up, you were the air that I could breathe. It gave me hope, gave me something to believe. Now I'm a God, your love came crashing in and pulled me out of the fire. I'm a survivor. Hey. Now all I can see are the fields of your grace. Wherever I run, you're leading the way. Shook the shackles off my feet, found redemption on my knees. You gave me hope, gave me something to believe. Now I'm alive and born again, rescued from the grip of sin. God, your love came crashing in and pulled me out of the fire. I'm a survivor.
Live again.
Now I'm alive and born again.
alive. We are healed. We are blessed here. We thank you for your sweet presence, Holy Spirit, in this house here tonight. We hope you feel it out there. Feel his presence. I want to ask everyone to pray for a move. We need Holy Spirit to manifest himself in this nation right now, to change the minds and hearts of men, to unify, reconciliate. Bring us together, Father. Bring us together right now. We need a move. Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe it. Yes, we can see that. Wonders are still what you do. We are here for.
Cause miracles happen when you move. Healing is coming in this room. Somebody get healed tonight. Somebody's healed tonight. Somebody gets a miracle tonight. Come on. Miracles happen.
God's presence is here for you right now. It's the greatest thing that you can ever have. Boy, if there was ever a song that we should sing, this is it, that we need a move. We need God to move in our hearts and our lives and our family and our bodies and our minds and this nation and our communities and every aspect of society. The only solution to any societal ill or heart ill or spiritual ill is God Himself. God is the answer. And we'll talk a lot about that tonight as we're renewing the mind series and we're dealing with relationship. But I just feel this. You know, the Bible talks about when Paul said, I was pressed beyond measure. He goes, I was pressed out of my ability and capability. John and I often talk about this, that sometimes I think God, specifically I know in regards to myself, likes to keep me in a corner where it's just, I'm completely dependent on Him. Are you there? I mean, there's an area that you go, if it not be for the Lord, what am I going to do with this? You know, I mean, there's just always an area. There's something that you say, I can't do this, God. I have to have you. And God's here for you. He's a very present help in the time of trouble. And I was thinking as you were singing that, because what burdens me more than anything, and John knows that I walk through days and carry a lot of pressure on myself sometimes, and some days are really great, and some days are, you know, if you feel a little bit bent out of shape. And Paul said, I was shipwrecked, and I was stoned, and I was, you know, beaten, and all these different things. He said, but none of this compared to the weight of the church. None of it compared to the weight of souls. The thing that I think burdens the heart of God the most, and I know for me burdens me the most, is the weight of souls. Every single day, I thank you for sending your prayer requests. There's not a day that I don't click on every one of them and put my hand on those and start praying, whether I call you out by specific name or whether I just read through them. See Allison walk in and I think about Deacon Chris being bedridden for 8 weeks and burdens on me. I carry those things. Now, I know that I'm not God, you're not God, John's not God, only God is God. But as a believer, we love one another. As a believer, when one rejoices, we all rejoice. And when you broke your wrist, with all you've gone through recently, it burns me. You know, I get concerned about Pastor Todd out there all the time. And, you know, I don't know, I'm just kind of like Mama Hen. Elder, I think it's being a pastor. It's that call that God puts on you. Feel those burdens. Maybe you have a burden for your family right now, a burden for your son or your daughter, a burden for a neighbor, a burden for somebody that you don't even know the condition of their soul. Give it over to the Lord. There's so much chaos and so much fighting and so much division and stuff, and the reality is our greatest burden should be for every single person to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. I get asked all the time, you know, people know that I'm the president's pastor, and they say, well, would you do that for Biden? Would you do that for Kamala? Would you do that for, of course I would. If anybody gave me an opportunity, you know, I would preach the gospel to Satan if he allowed me to. I'm so convinced of the power of the blood of Jesus, I would share the gospel with the devil. Except for, unfortunately, his story doesn't turn out too good. He's going to be cast into a pretty dark place one day. But that doesn't have to be with us. My point being is that give your burdens over to the Lord. He cares about you. And whatever it is that's weighing you down, whatever it is, maybe if it's a child or daughter, know that God loves them and cares about them more than you do. And prayer is real. And God hears our prayers, and He answers our prayers. And I'm telling you, I'm just taking a minute to minister to you right now, because in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. And so my sweet spot is just, it's been one of those days, it's kind of been one of those weeks, seems like months, but I'm telling you what, it seems like years for some people. But 2020, you're like, what happened? Just a lot of weight. But I'm telling you, in the presence of God, everything you need, it's just like, it'll wash right off you. It'll just come right off. So Spirit of the Living God, do what only you can do right now. Take away the yoke that the enemy has put on my friend right now. The hurt in their heart, the confusion in their mind, the burden that they're carrying, the weight, God, that they're pressed beyond their ability and their capability. Let them know that, yes, we recognize we're in a real war, that there's a clash of two kingdoms, that there is a real enemy that hates you and hates us as believers. But you so love us, and you're so much greater, God. And if we can just learn to lay our cares and cast our cares upon you and know how much you love us. So strengthen every physical body right now of every person that is sick. We just declare Isaiah 53 over you, that you were wounded according to our iniquities and transgressions. The chastisement of our peace is upon you, and with your stripes we are healed. I speak healing to you right now. You shall live and not die in the name of Jesus. For every burdened person right now that you're just maybe don't know how to homeschool and all the things that have changed, or the school's gotten locked down again, I just pray a patience for you. I pray a peace over you. For everyone who is full of anxiety and worry over things that they see on the news, or over COVID, or over things that you're going through, or economic distress, or mental torment, or emotional, right now I just pray the peace of God which passeth all understanding to keep your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. For every marriage that the enemy is coming to divide and bring strife into, I pray that you turn the heart of the husband toward the heart of the wife, and the heart of the wife toward the heart of the husband. And what the enemy's meant for bad, that you turn around for good, and you strengthen every family under the sound of my voice right now. And we know that, God, you hear our prayers and you answer our prayers in Jesus' name. I just felt like that we needed to pray. Thank you so much, baby. Thank you for leading us in the worship. Thank you so much, Anna, Joy, you guys, Greg, Victor. Love you guys. Elder, everybody here. We have a handful on Wednesdays. We haven't fully opened back up on midweek because we just, people show up, and that's good. So we welcome you. And if you're online, welcome to the greatest church on this side of heaven. Amen. We have distributed over 7 million pounds of food so far. It's just amazing what God's doing. We're doing a ton of other things just as well. But God is a good God. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians, we're going to worship the Lord with his tithe and your offering. Tithe, I really have a strong conviction about. I believe that belongs to the Lord. It's holy. But offering's free will. And the Apostle Paul says here in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, the entire chapter is about giving to God, about touching the ministering of the saints. And he says, it's superfluous for me to write to you. I know the forwardness of my mind. And he just goes into this. He talks about this offering he's received in verse 5. It's where we're going to pick up. Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort the brethren that they would go before you and make up beforehand your bounty, whereof you had noticed before that the same might be ready as a matter of bounty and out of covetousness. And he's talking about giving. He's talking about the offering here. I'm reading from the King James. He said, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purpose in his heart, because giving is a hard issue. So let him give, not grudgingly or even of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Literally means hilarious. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. As it is written, he is dispersed abroad. He's given to the poor. His righteousness remains forever. Now he that ministers seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food and multiplies your seed sown and increases the fruits of your righteousness, being enriched in everything to all bountifulness, which causes through us thanksgiving to God. And then he goes on and tells why. For the administration of this service not only supplied the want of the saints, but is abundant also by many thanksgiving to God. So it's really interesting. The whole chapter is all about giving. And he says, you know, if you sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. But if you sow bountifully, you're going to reap bountifully. And God, who is the one that gives you the seed to sow in the first place, is able to make that seed increase and able to make that seed multiply, as well as meet your everyday needs. And he doesn't put restrictions on here. Notice that, Minister Greg, he doesn't say, oh, with the exception of COVID, you know, with the exception of 2020, with the exception of whatever, 17 or whatever, let's say 1929, with the exception of when America went through a depression. No, God is God no matter what the situation or circumstance is. So stay in covenant with God. Know he is your source. He uses many different resources. Love to read these praise reports. Carrie writes in, says, Dear Pastor Paula, you asked for praise reports. I do send in your praise report, all right? So I wanted to share mine. My praise report is I am still alive. Praise God. And I can walk. I give God praise because I am not in a wheelchair after a head-on collision that happened last month. My SUV was completely totaled, but I am very grateful that I can still testify about his goodness in the midst of great suffering and pain. Thank you, God. Praise God. God is such a faithful God. Amen. Carrie, we just rejoice with you, and God is so good. He's an awesome God. And so why don't you go ahead right now and give him his tithe and your offering. You can do that by going to cityofdestiny.us or text to give, text COD at 321-244-3900. Go to paulawhite.org, or some people like to do 4577. That's text Paula White Ministry. That's PWM. You just put that text in. And then the easiest way, I love doing the internet. I'm old-fashioned. I still do PayPal. You can do Kindred. You do all kinds. You can do Cash App, but some people mail it in. 505 East McCormick Road, Apopka, Florida, 32703. If you're ever in the Orlando area, please come stop by and visit us Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. I would love to be your pastor if you're looking for a pastor. I think we've got the best church in the world. We've got the greatest volunteers, the greatest members. This church is full of love. I'm also download the Life Network for Women. You ready to get in the Word, guys? We're on series number 22, all right? Renewing the mind, because I think we'd be here forever. I keep teaching this because I obviously keep needing this. Have you ever noticed that about a pastor? They teach, you know, you pray and you hear from God. But I think really authentic pastors who don't cheat and get somebody else's sermon, and they actually get into the Word for themselves and study, you can really read their mail, because it's areas that the Word of God has spoken to them so much, or God's downloading to them. That's why it's been a call to prayer, a call for this nation, to be in a spiritual place. But also, to be in a spiritual place, there's got to be work on our mind, a renovation, taking out the old and putting in the new. So I decided to get specific. We did money, now we're doing relationships, and I might be stuck here for a while because we talked about connectedness matters. Last week, we got to the first part that you really cannot love others until you do what? First, love yourself. So it starts with wholeness, meaning no fragmentation. Proverbs 23:7, as a man thinketh, so is he, what? At last an act. So that's the original verb. How a man thinketh, how he feels in his heart, how he thinks, so he is at last an act. So your actions are just a reflection of what's in your heart. And heart's not your physical beating organ. It's the way you think about things, the way you feel about things. It's your soul, your mind, your will, your emotions. And so we've been studying Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, and I like to repeat it always, because I think it's something we should just get in our spirit. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, I read the Amplified, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies, dedicating all yourself set apart as a living sacrifice, holy and well-pleasing to God, which is your rational, logical, and intelligent act of worship. And do not be conformed to this world any longer with its superficial values and customs, but be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually. How many of us want to mature spiritually? Amen? That's a huge part of it. By the renewing of your mind, focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes, so that you may prove for yourself. We want other people, right? You may prove for yourself what the will of God is. You know, one of the biggest things a pastor is asked is, what is the will of God? But God's will is unique to each one of us. Now, his will is his word. So the will of God, the purpose of God, and what he's talking about here is the intention or the purpose of God for your life. And that's always going to be in alignment with God's word. Like I remember one time we were ministering and there was a girl that was coming just off the strip floor. And, you know, she'd come out of a lifestyle of being a stripper and being a prostitute. And she said, you know, I strip for Jesus. I said, honey, I love you. I said, and you know, God loves you, but we've got a little bit of work to do here. And you can say, how can you say that? Because it's not in alignment with God's word. Amen? Y'all are looking at me going, well, if you want to take a scripture out of context and say, you know, and to be honest with you, she ended up becoming an assistant for me, and she became one of my best workers. Now, there was a sanctification process that took place. There were several years of volunteer. There were several years of just because I don't care where you start in life. I think about where I started, an absolute disaster. And I have nowhere even near arrived, because none of us arrive till we see him face to face. And so all throughout our life, we are continually doing what? Spiritually maturing, progressively. But you know, the will of God is in alignment with the word of God. God's not going to ask you to do something that violates his word. Amen? All right. So, but God's will for you is specific. He's got a plan for you. You're unique. You're different. You carry certain personality traits, which means that how does that work in the context of making the whole body work together? How's that work in context of an intimate relationship? How do all these things work? So today, that's why we are going to lay this foundation probably for a while in relationships. So it says that you may prove for yourself what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect in his plan and his what? Purpose for you, right? So God has a specific intention for you. So the question we've been dealing with, we're going to finish this week, hopefully. There's three parts to it, is to be loved or not to be loved. Because all of us desire love. I quoted from Carlisle last week. We went through all point one, and you guys are going to be so glad because I took the pages out so I wouldn't even have anything to go over. So I'd get straight to point two, all right? So it's the only way to do it, Joy, or we'd be here for 2 hours, all right? So we are, first off, let me lay this foundation of just some basic things, and we looked at three things that we're going to constitute and that we're going to get into, and number one was that every human being has unconditional worth, and that's what I took out because I stayed on that for a long time. The second thing is love, and the third is continual growth. Now, I'll lead up to how we got to that, and how this all fits into renewing our mind and what God's word has to say. So I'm just going to hit number two and maybe number three tonight, all right? So when we look at this, we recognize we're spiritual beings that are having this human experience. So the core of you is spiritual. You are a spiritual being. It's the most important part. You're in this body. You have a mind, but you are a spiritual being having a human experience. Now, as a spiritual being, you are created in the image of God because God is spirit. Now, you are not God. He is God, but you're created in the image, which means likeness and resemblance of God. That's really important and very vital there because there's a lot, and I'm not going to get into the essence and the energy, but you really need to understand the Trinity and God and the fundamentals of our faith of Christianity. So when it says you're created in the image of God, that's a very, very, very powerful deep revelation right there. Because it eliminates a lot of what we did talk about last week, which was the greatest enemy often to the love of God is self-rejection, because you don't receive being the beloved. So if you don't love yourself, you really don't love what God created. And I don't mean like I love myself in a narcissistic way, meaning like, God, you don't make mistakes. There's no such thing as an accident. I'm not an accident. Maybe I've had some accidents, maybe I've made some mistakes, but I am not a mistake. I'm created in the image of God. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. So we've been given this gift of a spiritual nature. The greatest part of you is a spiritual nature, that we're able, just like God, because we're going to get to this, which is going to be the core of our teaching for all relationships, that God is love. So we are able to love and to be loved. In fact, so much so, it's the greatest need in all of our life. The greatest need. So love consists also of safety and validation and acceptance and acknowledgement and several things that go along with that. But just like God so loved the world that he did what? He gave his only begotten son. So we could say God's a giver, but what made God a giver? Because God was a lover. So loving made him giving. So yes, he's giving, but it's really because God is love. So everything that you end up having need of in your humanness is really because your spiritual nature that is made in the image of God. And so we've got to go back to the source of that. God also gave us this free will. Now, that's where it gets a little complex, right? Don't you kind of wish that he didn't give Adam and Eve that free will? No, I'm just kidding. So he gave this free will. And that free will gave us this ability to choose, which means that why it's so important to have a renewed mind, that we're taking out the old, and this is this constant work, and we're putting in the new. The Word of God is constantly washing us and cleansing our soul, because we have the ability to choose with a free will. That means that we are responsible, especially as believers, to direct our own lives. So you can't play the blame game and say, well, it's my mom's fault, it's my dad's fault, it's the way I was brought up. Now, those things all impacted you tremendously. I mean, the more I get in the Word, the more I know things, know thine own self, be true to thine own self, all the things that you start knowing about yourself, it's like, yeah, man, and you're just fighting these formations that largely 85% of your personality was framed and formed the first 6 years, primarily by your parents or whoever the caretakers or the authorities were in your life, whether that was a teacher or a pastor or whoever that would have been, an elder sister or brother. So as adults, we have choices. Choices, because we have a free will. As a child, you didn't get as many choices. But as adults, you do. Choice to stay, choice to leave. Choices how we direct our life, how we direct our decisions on a daily basis. You see, we can direct ourselves towards love and towards all that's good. Or we can direct ourselves and our thoughts towards evil and towards all that's bad. We daily make decisions that end up determining our destiny. Because remember, purposes of God, that's the intention of God, but destiny, your destination, where you land eternally and at the end of your life, is based on your decisions, how you direct your life. So all of us deep inside want to be loved. That's number one. We all want love, but we don't always know how to get it, and we certainly don't always know how to give it. Our lives are too precious for us to sit around just hoping and waiting for love to just happen. Like some people just think like God's going to drop a man out of the sky or something. Might put him on Southwest, but I mean, God, some people just think like he's going to like something. But I'm going to tell you, there was a lot of preparation in my life before John came. There's a whole lot of counseling. There was 9 years. There was a lot of things that God needed to do in me. And I didn't know if I would ever get married again. I really didn't. I knew it was God's best. I knew it was his will. But I also knew I wasn't going to settle. I didn't have this list like need to be tall, dark, and handsome, or short, stubby, and cute. There was no list like that for me, because I felt like God knew exactly what I needed. And I would know when God joined something together, because I I know when God doesn't join something together. Somebody say amen. I'm not the only person in that one, all right? So our lives are not just to sit around and hope and wait and want. I'm going to take you on this biblical pathway and how we renew our mind of what it is to be in a love relationship that God has ordained. Our lives are too valuable for us to hold ourselves back and to be afraid of connection because we've been rejected before, or we've been hurt before, or we've had pain in our life. You know, everybody has pain. Every single one of us can sit down with our sob stories, and it's not fair for any one of us to say, well, my sob story is worse than your sob story. Because everybody has it. And everybody has it to a different degree, and everybody has a different threshold, and every person's been hurt. And that's part of humanity. But hurt doesn't have to stop you in life. It doesn't have to make you bitter. It doesn't have to make you stuck in life. God wants to use all of those things. In fact, it is usually in your deepest brokenness that your greatest beauty comes forth, because it's God's beauty. It's in brokenness often that we discover, because we're at the end of ourself, that we discover our deepest desire and need for God. Because we come to that end place. Anybody ever been to that end place? You're just like, man, I need you desperately, God. And those aren't bad places to be. So it's you've been hurt, and I'm genuinely sorry. And I mean that. I even go as far as to say, I apologize to you on behalf of the person who hurt you. Because one of the hardest things for someone who walks around wounded and offended is never hearing they're sorry from the person who hurt them. And sometimes all you need, it's like maybe it'll be a decade later, God sends someone into your life to say, I'm sorry. And like what they're saying they're sorry for is not even what you're really hurt on the inside about, but it releases you. You need to hear, or you need to write a letter of forgiveness just to go, I release you, and write it and say everything you want to really say to them. Because you know it's not going to go to them anyway. You don't even know if they're still alive, all right? Just do it. Get it out. Put it there. And then burn it. Do whatever you've got to do with it. It's okay. There's good ways, healthy ways to be angry and sin not. And so the point of it is don't stay stuck in pain. John, you wrote this song recently you're doing some writing for Journey, and you wrote this song kind of about a lover that just never knows if they're going to find love again because they're still hurt, right? And they just want to be stuck in that place and think your life's going to be gone before you know it. So what I'm saying is you're too valuable to hold yourself in a place of bondage. Our lives are too short to live in resentment, to live in bitterness, or to hold on to blame that keeps us stuck, passive, motionless, and unable to get to the destination that deep inside as a child of God that you desire. So God has this path. And go, well, what is it? I'm getting to it. God has this path to love and to be loved. But you have to actively pursue it. So James chapter 2:17 says, so also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. So what does that tell me? If I want this Cinderella, let's take every girl's dream, right? If I want this wonderful marriage, right? If I want this dream life, what I have to work on myself. It doesn't just happen. Nothing just happens, right? So I want this. Everybody's like, man, I want to marry. People are like, I want to marry, man. Like, I want a marriage, and I'm so glad we can be an inspiration to people, baby. I want a marriage like you and John. Trust me. We've both gone through a lot to become the people, and we're still working to become the people God wants us to become as a couple and as individuals, because you attract likeness. So if I was just a broken mess when you would have met me, if I was just, completely in debt and negative all the time and talked about how I was abused and my dad killed himself and I just talked about my ex-husband all the time, or, you know, the world's so ugly, and I brought all this problem. maybe if you were real, like, controlling or codependent or something else, maybe we would attract it if you were that broken. But if you were a whole person, you might have thought for a moment, maybe I'm a fixer, and probably within about a week or two as a whole person, you would have recognized that's not my job to do anyway. And he would have been skadoodle, scat. Because why does somebody who has it together want somebody who absolutely has nothing to offer spiritually, emotionally, intellectually, in every way? So if you want greatness, and I mean that sincerely, because I believe a spiritual person's a great person. So if you want a great spiritual person, if you want greatness, where do we have to work on? Not them, us. It all comes back to us. So we have to renew our mind from the old patterns and the old ways and access our God-given ability to love and to be deeply loved. Now, one of the things that you've got to know, we went over this, you cannot control life. You can't control God. God is God. God's going to do what he wants. I mean, I wish every one of my prayers could just maneuver God. Don't let somebody else take that out of context and say it like, oh, God, do this, because then we'd never have pain in life, right? If he just answered every prayer like that, elder, then everybody would get healed and everybody would be, there'd be no suffering, there'd be no pain, there'd be no distress, but that's not how it works. You know, God allows us to go through things. Why? Because we are progressively, spiritually maturing. And so you don't get to control God. You can't control your spouse. You can't control how much your children love you or don't love you. You can't control your friends. You can't control the world. You can't control the riots. You can't control the president. You can't control the climate of everything. And we want this nice little package. We're going to control it all. No, it's not. You can't control any of it. And so everybody gets what? Reactive to it instead of responsive to it. And what I mean is, what can I do? I can't control anything when it boils down to it except myself. I can make changes in my life to increase my opportunity to have more fulfillment, to fall deeper in love with God, to be a better person, to love by directing myself toward deeper loving and deeper connection. That's why we started this whole series with connectedness matters, because it's the most fundamental thing that God made us. Man, it's not good for the man to dwell alone. Should not, but I will make him a helpmeet, a counterpart. See, you're the only one that's able to make real changes in your life. You're the only one. When I have rough days or have tough times, you know, I turn to my safe place, and that's my safe place right here. So y'all pray for Pastor John. I turn to my safe place. But even at that, I'm careful how much I say. Because I know, I mean, he probably thinks I say a lot, but trust me, I'm still holding some restraint there in self-control, because it's not John's responsibility. He's a good listener. He's caring. He does everything he can. But at the end of the day, I know it's not John's responsibility to change my attitude. It's not John's responsibility to put boundaries in my life. It's not John's responsibility to lift something off me. It's my responsibility. And it's not my responsibility to change him. That's how the real world works. That's how real life is. That's how the Bible teaches us. All right, this is going to get tight before it gets right, I can tell. So we all have known how painful it is to wait around or to wait for someone that you care about to turn around and to acknowledge your worth and your goodness or your presence. Just acknowledge you. And I'm not talking about in an intimate relationship. It could be your work relationship. It can be as a pastor. I'll be honest, it's Pastor Appreciation Month. Not one single person has said, happy Pastor Appreciation. It's Boss's Day. Was it yesterday? Not one. I employ a lot of people. Not one single person said happy boss day. That's okay. Don't worry. I didn't take it personal. Y'all can tell. I'm just kidding. Now, I'm just giving examples, but for real. I'm being serious that does not bother me, because I can appreciate myself. I can celebrate myself. There are deeper things that really do bother me. So that is really being surface right there. There are deeper things that bother me. But if you're waiting like, well, they didn't do this and he didn't give me that. And what I'm trying to express to you here is every single person knows what it is to have pain, whether it's in a workplace or whether it's in your home life or whether it's with your own family, not to have the acknowledgement or the appreciation or the love of your worth and of your presence. Because you just want people, this is our makeup, a person to begin loving you in a way that you've always dreamed of. But the answer here is not to try to force a person to respond as you desire. As painful as it can be, it's important to understand and to choose to respect an individual's freedom of that person. That's so important what I'm teaching you right now. Because a person is free to dote on you or to ignore you. A person is free to show up or not show up. And if you get yourself in a situation that you either passively, aggressively, or just with a straight up Jezebel spirit start trying to maneuver a person, you're going to wreck a relationship, whether it's a friendship, whether it's intimacy, whether it's a marriage, because the first thing that you have to give is what God gave us, freedom. Freedom for a person to choose. Freedom, and it's hard. It's hard. Then you go, well, man, you know, when I did this, shouldn't I at least, I mean, couldn't you have sent a thank you card? You know, I did it free, paid my own expenses to it all. A thank you? So all of us, the transparency that I'm saying in a shallow way up here is that all of us have felt this in a very deep way by somebody or something. And the reality, if we're going to get real satisfaction with love, the first thing you've got to acknowledge is an individual's freedom. They're free to do anything, including ignore you, including not to accept you, including to even be abusive to you if you allow that. Because they are free. You don't have to stay there. You don't have to put up with that emotionally, verbally. You certainly never should put up with that physically. Shouldn't put up with it in any way. That was where we left off last week, didn't we? We talked about being a doormat. We gave those acronyms, right, of what that was. So that's painful. But as painful as it is, it's important to understand that you choose to respect the individual's freedom of a person. Every person has the freedom to make decisions. Respect that. You have the freedom to say potato. I have the freedom to say potato. Okay? If it bothers me bad enough, I don't have to be around you if you say potato. So that's freedom. We getting this? I'm actually drilling all this in for a really important reason. Each person has his or her own personal opportunity to choose love or to reject it. So I have my own opportunity. Remember, give a person their individual freedom because that's what God gave you, but I have my opportunity to choose love or to reject it. So if someone close to you chooses to put off pursuing conscious loving, that does not mean that you have to put it off in your life. If someone else chooses not to love, it doesn't mean that you don't get to be loved. What do you mean? Let's keep building this out. Instead of spending all of your energy trying to force someone to change, it's essential that you take hold of your personal energy so that you can use it to get through the process of loving yourself enough to change yourself. In other words, instead of taking all my energy and trying to get somebody else to do something, I can take my energy and love God enough and love myself enough to give myself enough respect to change me. Because you can't change someone else. And pray for them. And you can ask God to change them. And you pray that those eyes be open and that those ears hear. But even at that, there are a lot of people that still stay deaf. Jesus always asked for those ears to be open and those eyes to see. But not everybody got open eyes. Not everybody got open ears. You see, when you begin to respect yourself and love yourself enough to give the energy that you would spend trying to change someone else on changing yourself, in this way, we imitate God's love for us. Now, how? See, God does not force his love on us, nor does he force us to love him. The very one that created us, the very one that put breath in our body, the very one that took dust and formed man and breathed and man became a living soul. The very one that is your life source, whether you recognize it or don't recognize it. The very one, I know you think it's you that has the ability that you're still alive. The only reason you're alive is because the breath, the ruah of God is in you. The energy. The only reason anything's still, because in him is life, the Bible says. It says, in him I live and I move and I have my being. Now, I know that. I recognize that, I celebrate that, I honor that, but God does not force me to. He suggests for me to. If you have breath, Psalm 150, let everything that have breath praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Psalm 34, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually, come on, be in my mouth. But God doesn't force me to. He says, okay, if you don't follow that one today, Paula, I'm going to strike you down dead. So God himself does not force his love on me. He's a gentleman. The Holy Spirit's a gentleman. Nor does he force me to love him. So in essence, let us start practicing the art of love with freedom and grace towards ourselves and others. What do I mean? Well, we started last week talking about in order to be healthy and whole, ultimately to love others with the love of God, I must have and know these three things: my unconditional human worth and value. We've covered it. I'm not going over one single note. I took them all out. Number two, love. And number three, continual growth. So let's just look at love. Can you believe I did that? I skipped the whole, this is all new teaching tonight, all right? So number two, the love of God is the absolute foundation of the child of God in any and every relationship. Did you hear what I said? The love of God is the absolute foundation that is vital for any and all relationships. 1 John 4:8. Anyone, and we're going to come back to this, anyone who does not love does not know God. Because God is love. Now, it doesn't say anyone who does not love God does not know God. It says anyone who does not love does not know God. So when we see all the things that we're seeing, it's you remember, you have to give that respect that God gives. I'm not going to call it respect necessarily the right thing, but you have to give that understanding that God himself gives freedoms to individuals. God himself. So whether it's in an intimate relationship, someone at work, whether it's what you're looking at in society, listen to the scripture. Anyone who does not love does not know God. Because God is love. So the problem when there is a lack of love somewhere, anywhere, there is a lack of knowledge of God. There's a lack of intimacy, not head knowledge. Intimacy, yada. Adam knew Eve and conceived Seth, yada. Genosko in the Greek, yada in the Hebrew, to be one with. And that's what God calls us to. See, the life that you long for and the life that you look for and the life that you're looking is in the ability to be loved and to also give love. But if you don't develop the character and this character of love, then no relationship's ever going to work. So let me give you four things and go into a deep description of love, because I can talk on this literally for 3 months and we'll never be able to describe it, because people go, I love my dog, I love pizza, I love God. How do you love pizza and God in the same category? So there's no real like way to describe this, so I'm gonna start building this case around it. Love is, number one, a feeling that you experience. It is a feeling, you experience it. Love is also, number two, an attitude. We'll cover all these. Love wants what's best for the loved one at each moment. Love is also a decision and a commitment that you make every single day. Sometimes you gotta will it, even though it's difficult. Some days you don't feel it. You just will it because it's a decision, it's a commitment. And love is a skill that is cultivated. See, love provides for us emotional connection and a sense of belonging. Loving is something we actually learn to do. Now, I'm going to read to you 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Let's go there real quick, all right? Because I'm going to take this backwards and then reverse it. I actually should end with this, but I want to start here and back you up somewhere. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 says, though I speak with tongues of men, of angels, and have not charity, I'm become a sounding brass or tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, which is love, I'm reading in the King James, I'm nothing. And though I bestow and give away all my goods and feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not love, it doesn't profit me anything. Love suffered long and is kind. Love envies not. Love does not vaunt itself. It's not puffed up. Love does not behave itself unseemly. Love does not seek her own. It's not easily provoked, and it thinks no evil. Love doesn't rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. It bears all things. It believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Or whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away with. And he goes on and he says, when I was a child, I spoke like a child and I understood as a child. I thought as a child, but when I became a man, as I progressively began to spiritually mature, I put away childish things. So he's actually calling childish things like the gifts of the Spirit, which are pretty powerful. But he's saying they're nothing if you don't have love. He's saying if I can remove mountains because I have the greatest faith of anyone, because if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you can say to that mountain, be thou removed, and it shall be cast in the sea. If I can remove a mountain because I have more faith than any person on this earth, because God honors his word and he honors his name, but I don't have love, then I'm nothing. Because it means that God's honoring his word and he's honoring his name, but I don't know God. Because if I know God, God is love. And he that does not love it does not know God. It doesn't say, if your husband does the right things and you love him during that, then okay, that's your free pass. No, there's not conditions. There's not these conditions. It's going to be pretty black and white right here. Then he says, as I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. For I know in part, but then I'll know as I know. So now abideth faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these three is love. So he's saying, man, I'd prophesy. If I could speak in tongues and give the entire interpretation, if I can do all these great things, but I don't have love. If I burn my body, if I give all my goods away to the poor, but I don't have love. So let's break down this. There's qualities. He says, love endures long. It's patient. It's kind. It suffereth long. It's not envious. It's not jealous. It's not boastful. It's not self-seeking. It's not resentful. It bears up under anything and never fails. So let's look at each one. It endures long. What does that mean? It's patient. Means to be kind. Endure means to stand firm under pressure. It suffers long. It's not envious. It means it pains you when you're envious. It pains you to see someone else successful. So it rejoices when someone else is doing well. It's not like, well, you did this, but I'm doing all this. Love is that if you never get rewarded here on earth, love rejoices over your success. Love rejoices over whatever it is you got, promotion, reward. It's not jealous. Jealousy, we've often said, jealousy is kind of two different things, but jealousy is fear of someone being preferred over you. So it's not a fear that someone is preferred over you. It's not boastful. It's not haughty. It's not rude. It doesn't act unbecomingly. So love doesn't embarrass people. Love doesn't tell all your husband's secrets in front of somebody or your secrets. Love doesn't, it's not haughty, doesn't make you feel put down, doesn't act rude. Love is not self-seeking. Ooh, this is God's standard of love. Okay? We've got some work to do, don't we, guys? So love's not self-seeking. Oh, flesh, die right now in Jesus' name. It's not selfish. Selfishness is the matrix of fear. Because fear is born out of selfishness. Me, 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 me. I was reading about a good intimate relationships today and about family. There's a couple different authors that I absolutely love just to read and constantly reading. And as I was reading it today, it's interesting because in intimacy, it was dealing with this, that it's all about the number one quality, the number one thing that creates intimacy is to serve one another. You know, the root word for family is serve. Family means serve. Husband means house band. So the root of that is to serve. I'll get to that later. So it's not resentful. It doesn't keep an accounting book of everything and every wrong that has been done to you. Uh-oh. You know that fight? Well, 20 years ago, when you looked at her, when you did this, it doesn't keep the list. If God himself forgives us and no longer remembers into the depths of the sea, then how do we get to keep an accounting book against people's wrongs? Why are we always trying to pluck the speck out of our brother's eye when we've got a pole protruding from our own? It bears up under anything and everything, which means it covers the scandal with silence. Y'all are like, that's so good. We need to die to some flesh if we're going to get... See, we all want love. Like, we all want love. But it's like... I'm going to read it. This is the etymology, guys. I went into the Greek, the Aramaic, the Hebrew. I tried to get anything to change this a little bit. I did. I tried some leeway on all of it. Like, loosen it up, God. This is the etymology, elder. Bears up under anything and everything. It means it covers the scandal with silence. Do you know almost the moment somebody finds something out about you, how many people they want to tell? Make it. Now, there are people that have spiritual authority. Maybe it's a husband with a wife or a pastor or, you know, person in a governmental place. Or there's certain things that, you know, there's certain levels of civil authority and spiritual authority. And I'm talking to you in spiritual terms right now, in spiritual terms. There's certain accountability that should be take place in every person's life. So you're not just this lone island. We've already taught about that. But it's so easy. Like, we, again, church is notorious for like shooting its wounded and just hurting its own. But that's not what love does. Love never fails. It never fails. Now watch this. You ready? Because we can't really love ourselves. What are the two commandments in the New Testament? Love God with all your heart, your soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as you love yourself, for all the laws of the Word of God and the prophets hinge on these two commandments. Say, sums it up in this. Are you ready? So if I want this intimate, wonderful marriage or this great relationship with my children, or to be loved by the people that I pastor, or to be validated, or whatever I do, to serve this country, any whatever your purpose is, or to have an amazing love relationship with God, it's all going to start in the same place. So we're laying this pathway out as we build this, how we renew our mind, because I'm going to get to the problems, because I'm showing you the solutions. I usually show you the problems and then go to the solutions. I'm doing it backwards today. So 1 John chapter 3, verse 13 through 14. It gets a little bit tighter. The person who does not love is spiritually dead. Now think about this right now. The person who does not love, I want you to ask yourself real questions. Like, can you ask yourself, do I really love this man I live with? Seriously, do I really love that woman I live with? If I really love them, there's a difference between wickedness and weakness too, because people make mistakes in their weakness. It doesn't mean you can continue to live in that because you're spiritually growing. If I really love them, I just went through it. Love endures long. It's not jealous. It's not boastful. It's not self-seeking. It's not resentful. It bears up under anything. It doesn't fail. Do I really love my pastor? And it's pretty amazing, because people sit up under you. I've been in ministry for 36 years. And they'll trust you with their soul. There are people that say, you know, there have been maybe one or two people that said, you know, something about Pastor Appreciation Month or something. They just said, you know, we appreciate you or whatever. But they trust you with their soul. They trust you to teach the Word of God accurately. But they don't trust you with what are foolish things in this world. And what do I mean like that? Like, they don't trust maybe a pastor with finances. They question me politically, why I serve President Trump. But yet you would sit under my teaching, and I'm not making this political whatsoever. Because it's amazing, people think like if you have an assignment that you're complicit with everything. Or that you're in agreement with everything. I can tell you right now, I don't agree with not one single human. There's not a human being on this planet, ask my husband or my son, that I agree with everything. There's not one, and there's not one that you agree with everything. Because if you do, you don't have a mind of your own. But that doesn't mean I don't love you. Joy doesn't mean I don't love you. I respect you enough to love you with what I believe is a God love, to give you the ability to make your own choices and freedom. And I pray that you direct your life in the right way, and that I can be responsible in the Word to help you do that with my gifting and calling. It's amazing how many people are like, oh, that, you know, or they'll go get married. They'll just run off. Get married, we'll go to a judge, and they'll come up and say, help us. I'm like, did you think about this before you went to the judge? I mean, seriously, did you think about the most important decision outside of salvation is who you're going to marry? And what you do with that? Did you talk to your spiritual authority? So watch what I'm saying. The person who does not love is what? Spiritually dead. Now, I'm saying all this for a reason, because we always say, well, I love them. I love them. Ask yourself, according to the way that God lays out love, do you really love them like that? Some of you don't even love your own children. I'm being for real. Because according to the Word of God, if I don't love, I'm spiritually dead. So let's say it like this. If I'm spiritually dead, I'm incapable of loving. So it goes back to having to have spiritual life. How do I have spiritual life? An encounter with Jesus every single day. The more that I get weighed down with natural stuff, I'm telling you, it has been a rough couple weeks. And people around me, I tell you, I'm like, it's not you. It's not you. It's me. Now, whether they believe that or not, I don't know. But I tell them, I give them advance warning. I promise you, it's not you right now. Please be patient with me. I'm bearing a lot of weight in this moment. And I'll be very vocal. I'll say it, and then if they can hear it, then hear it. If they can't, watch out, because I don't mean to. I wouldn't hurt a fly. Elder knows that. My mama would always say about me, Paula would not hurt a fly. I wouldn't. I actually don't. I'd like shoo it away. You know, now Rocco, my dog, likes to chase lizards, and I try to get him out of his mouth before he can get to him, you know, because I'm like, it's still a creature of God. I'm just one of those people. I'm like, no, you know, like, I'm just a big lover. I really am, because God loved me so much and made me alive. Now, when I get weighted down in life and I see myself tending to the cares of this world more, I know what I have to do. I know my steps. I need to be in his presence, because his presence is breathing life into me. His presence brings me back to center. His presence fills me with peace and joy. So those that don't love are what? Spiritually dead. So you have to practice love to perfect love. So I have to practice enduring long. I have to practice not being jealous. I have to practice not being boastful, haughty, rude, unbecomingly. I have to practice not being selfish. I have to practice not being resentful. Why am I the only one in here acting like I'm the one that has to practice, all right? I have to practice to bear up under anything. Did you have to say anything, God? I mean, could you say bear up under this? Love bears up under anything. Couldn't you like put a few things there? And once you graduate one thing, he'll let you go through another thing. I have to practice not letting love fail, which means I have to have a stick-to-ity. Stick it out. For better, for worse, in good and in bad. You have to practice love to perfect it. And that's a decision that you have to make every single day, because God gave you the free will. So you create this inner sense of safety by beginning to strengthen your ability to be consistent. Now I'll get just through these next few points. We're going to pray in 5 minutes or so. If you say you're going to show up at a certain time, then show up. Say, what does this have to do with love? A lot, you'll see. If you make a commitment to do something, follow through with it. Practice being consistent. Be consistent in your speech. Be honest. You know, Asher will look at me and she'll tell a little, my mom used to call him a furtel, because that was my maiden name. She goes, is that a furtel? Which meant a fib, a lie, right? And Asher will tell something, and all of a sudden she'll get guilt, my little four-year-old daughter. Her eyes get this big. She tells on herself with her body language. You know, I won't even know she's not telling the truth at something. And she goes, starts looking at me like this. I go, Asher? And she goes, oh, well, I'm so sorry. Don't spank me for lying. Don't spank me for lying. She knows right away. It's like even a child knows. Look, when they're not being truthful with herself, practice being honest. And she'll confess on herself. I lied. What'd you lie about? I hit Nikki. Okay, that's why your brother's crying. So she'll practice being consistent in your speech, meaning being honest. Practice being consistent in your time, showing up on time. Practice being consistent in your patterns. Practice being consistent, following up. Why? Think about a person that you know who's almost all the time they're late. They make promises, but they don't keep them. They make promises, but they don't do it. How safe would you feel traveling to a foreign country with that person? Well, y'all are like, nope, ain't gonna happen. In the same way, the more dependable you show yourself to be, the more confidence you will have to let go of your fear and to travel to where love abounds. Now, where does love abound? Inwardly, most people are aware that they want some form of love. Yet you probably wonder, what is love and where can I get it? Our first idea of love was formed by the actions and the words of our parents or those who took care of us. And no one, I don't care how great of a home you think you came from, we all like to, our brains play trick on of us. Or how bad you think it was. No one had perfect parents. No one had a perfect upbringing. There was something that was flawed. Not everything. Some had a better one. Some didn't. But there was some kind of situation. That's called humanity. So if you want to gain a full understanding of love, you have to go to a perfect source. Because the problem is we imitate in that subconscious area, and this is where we're going to get into the renewing of the mind. We imitate in that subconscious area those patterns, those habitual patterns of thought. That means we think so habitually without even being conscious of it that it's now become a belief. And those were passed down generationally from the way that you were formed in your childhood. So in your adult life, you're always looking to fix what went wrong in your childhood. You're looking for the kind of love that you didn't receive. That's why you'll attract an opposite. There's all kinds of reasons that we'll get into why those reasons are. So I can't go back to the way I was formed in the natural. And why did I take almost 40 minutes to explain to you that you are made in the image of God, you are a spiritual being, and that God is love, and that if you don't love, you're spiritually dead? Because the only source you can go to really be able to form right is the true source of love. Because you might have had great parents, you might have had not so great parents, you might have had a caretaker, a pastor, whoever was good and whoever was flawed. But if you want to gain a full understanding of love, you have to go to the perfect source of love. 1 John 4:7-8 this time. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever love has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love God does not know God, because God is love. So there are five things here. Number one, God is love. Number two, when you love, you know God. Number three, the love that you share with yourself and others ultimately comes from God. Number four, we know that God is spirit, which means he's supernatural. He's not flesh and blood. He's supernatural. So if love comes from God, we know that love is not a natural thing, but it is a supernatural thing. So I'll talk to you as we get deeper in teaching later, because there's some really key elements that I'm saying something, because if you just love with a natural love, that's going to fade. But if you love with a supernatural, which is a God love, because God is supernatural, that is going to be sustainable. Number five, therefore, how do you access love then? So if we look at this, I'm building a case. God's love, when you love, you know God. The love you share with yourself and others ultimately comes from God. We know God's spirit, so he's supernatural. So if it comes from God, we know it's not a natural thing, it's a supernatural thing. Therefore, in order to access love, what do I have to do? Go have great hot sex? No. How do I access love? Why y'all, everybody got quiet on that one, right? How do I access love? Everybody's like, I don't do that. I'm a Christian. Okay. Praise the Lord. Therefore, to access love, we do not pick it from a tree. We don't dig it up from the ground. In other words, there's a path. It is what? Spiritual. Love we have established, this whole teaching, is that love is spiritual. It grows in our heart and it comes from God. So the only way for me to truly love, so what's all that we're seeing in the world? We're seeing a love crisis, right? Even in churches, in the world, and everywhere else, with ethnicity, racism, lawlessness, all of it. We can call it all out right now. Divorce rate, suicide, people hating themselves, anxiety, worry, depression, all of it. What's the problem? Love doesn't come from you're cute, I'm cute, you're hot, I'm hot, let's be codependent and make this work. Love is spiritual. Real love is spiritual. It comes from God. And I've taken an entire day, an entire evening to teach this, because what does it teach me? When I love, I put God's love into action. You see, love, true love, grows in our heart, and it comes from God. So it teaches me that when I love, I start putting God's love into action, because now I've become one. I'm in the image of God. I'm created in the image of God. I'm now one with God, right? So I'm spiritually activated. I'm born again, which means I'm from above. That's what born again means. I'm from above. I'm not from here. I live here, but I'm not from here because I'm a spirit being. So therefore, love is able to flow through me, that even when I do get in my flesh and I see those other things where I'm not patient, I am rude, I am selfish, I'm not enduring, I am failing, or whatever other kind of day I have, guess what starts to happen? Because I'm connected and I'm abiding in Him, it's not that I'm perfect all the time, it's that immediately I have conviction. Because it's like, and then what do? I don't get frustrated with the other person. Who am I getting frustrated with? Myself. Because I recognize this isn't about you. Because no matter what you do to me doesn't determine how I love. No matter what you don't do to me doesn't matter how I love. What matters how I love is how I am connected with God. Because love is spiritual. So love doesn't really have to do, and I'm grateful. Because that's just a characteristic and an outflow of anyone who does give you acceptance and validation or safety or provision or any other thing that is God so loved the world that He gave. So God's giving, is He not? But the Bible doesn't say God is giving, does it? It says God is love. And a characteristic or an outflow of that love is that He happens, is that He's giving. It's part of His nature. But it's not, God is giving, therefore He loves. No, God is love, therefore He gave. You see? So if I need the course correction in my life because I recognize, boy, this 1 Corinthians 13 that is the best description of spiritual love is not flowing. Paul, I see some blockage there. You're too tired, or maybe you're too angry, or you're upset, or maybe you're bored, or you have anxiety. There's a whole checklist I have for you, trust me. My shrink's given me a lot of them over the years. It wasn't a shrink, it was a psychologist. But anyway, a therapist. I've got all the checklists. They're really helpful when they're good Christian ones, all right? So they help you get these. So what do you have to do? So the more that I engage, this is important. We're going to pray. I've got 7 minutes. When I love, I put God's love into action. I engage in a supernatural act from my spirit. So in doing this, I know God. So I can't do this if I don't know God. Because love is what? Supernatural. So I now engage in a supernatural act from my spirit. You go, how do people make it in relationships? Whether it's a working one, a pastoral one. Whether it's, you know, everybody's like, members are always like, I want to leave that church. You don't think pastors think I want to leave that church too? I'm going to leave that church. Everybody's like, you don't think a pastor goes, I want to leave too. People are people, right? Greg, you and I, 20, you and I are any different. We just have different gifts, different callings, different mantles. But God doesn't go, oh, Paula's better. Oh, Twana's better. Oh, Victor's better. Oh, Phyllis is better. He loves us all. We just have unique giftings and different callings and different purposes. So see what I'm saying here? So what happens is you've got to engage in a supernatural act from your spirit. I'm not going to stick in that marriage. Man, those kids, I'm not going to talk to them anymore. No, you've got to engage. They're just dumb millennials. I'm just kidding. I'm only teasing, guys. They just, my mom used to always tell me, she's always like, how wrong I was and how right she was. And I'm like, oh man, she's so stupid. And she'd think to me, oh man, she's so stupid. And then as I got older, I was like, my mom was really smart. Brad was so stupid. I'm just kidding. And now Brad's like, he's so smart. One day he's going to think about his teenage kids. No, he's like, I'll never think that. Just wait till they're teenagers, Brad. All right? Because these are the cycles of life. So to really love, come on, we engage in a supernatural act from our spirit. In doing this, I know God. God is love, and to be truly loving is to be like God in his very nature. So how do I get to this love? Here's your pathway. Remember, you're created in the image of God. God has planted you by his grace with the ability to access his love. So that the beauty of this is in a moment, you can be like, really, you can be, I've described all these things, hurt, painful, offended, stuck. You can be in any different situation. But as a born-again believer, it means I can access and allow God, because I have a free will, to let his love flow through me. And I can literally shift that fast. Literally. Or I can stay stuck. Or I can shift. Because what is it? Allowing God to access me. And if I allow God to access me, God is love. And so what's going to be the output of God accessing me and me accessing God? I'm going to start loving. And love's going to overflow regardless. And then I might get a little upset because I get weighed down here, weighed down there or that. But what do I need to, again, God, you have access to me. I mean, sometimes you just need to take a break. I mean, sometimes I don't say you need to go take a nap or something, but you know what I really need to do is get in worship, get in his word. That's the way I access God. I need to get in prayer. That's the way I access God. I get in his word and I start reading about him. I start talking to him and I start worshiping him. And as I do, his love begins to flow. You see, he created you to form loving relationships with others, with him and within yourself. And we know that hate and apathy are the absence of love. So one way to think of love is this, and we're concluded. Come on up here, guys. To love is to want to love, to live at its fullest capacity in the heart of each person that we encounter, to encourage and not block the true spiritual growth of ourselves and others. We can always learn more about God, and we can always learn more about love. Love does not change. It doesn't. But our idea of it can and does change as we grow in our understanding of it and as we practice it in our everyday life. Love wants every true good for others. Now hear what I said. Love wants every what? True good for others. See, to love yourself then is to desire every true good for yourself. Because love wants every true good for others. So to love yourself means it wants true good. Because you can't love your neighbor unless you love yourself. Or put in whatever name you want. You can't love your children. You can't love your spouse. You can't love this. You can't love it. Put whatever you want there until you first love yourself. And that doesn't happen until you love God with all your heart, your soul, and mind. So that means to love yourself then is to desire every true good for yourself while simultaneously desiring every true good, not just for the people you like, but for all humanity, for people all over the world, people everywhere. Because you cannot have bitter waters and sweet waters flowing. You can't say you love God and hate someone because their ethnicity, or hate someone because of their socioeconomic, or hate someone because their personality. That's impossible, because you're a child of God. Honestly, people that aren't even saved and are walking in wickedness, I can stand here before God and before all humanity saying there's no hate in my heart. There's not one person, there's not one being I hate. None. Not whatsoever. Now, I don't like wickedness. I hate wickedness working. I hate acts of evil that work through people to bring harm to other people. I don't like that. But that's a spiritual thing I'm dealing with. And the love of God hates. There are things that God hates. That there are abominations to God. hates certain things, hates evil. Doesn't, it's wrong. If a child is being molested, it's evil. And I get upset about it. If someone is being persecuted, bullied, done wrong because of whatever reason, it's wrong. I hate injustices. Don't like it. The problem is our understanding of true good. Because what did I say here? Love wants every true good for others, which means for yourself and for others. The problem with our understanding of true good, it's often blurred by the definitions that we learn through our parents and through other unrealistic expectations. So here's two things, and I'm done. Commit to fearlessly explore truths that we find in our innermost self through God's word, through relationship with him, and invite the Spirit of God to activate your mind, or to activate and to renew your mind by enlightening you as what true good and love really is. See, your definition outside of God's word of true love is wrong. Bottom line, your definition of true good outside of God's word is wrong. Just is. Because love is spiritual. Love is spiritual. Now, it manifests in natural ways. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. God is what? Love. It didn't say God is giving, so he loved the world. No, it said God is love, so he gave. And there's a lot of things God did. There's a lot of different stuff that love will cause you to be. There's a lot of things that love will cause you to do. But love is spiritual. And your source of love has to come from God. Love is supernatural. Let's pray. Father, I pray over every person right now. There's an empty love tank. It means there's an empty God tank. I pray that you would fill them with the Spirit of God right now. I pray that you would fill them so deep, because there will always be a longing, there will always be a searching, there will always be a lacking in our lives until that God tank gets filled. Because it's really not a love tank, it's a God tank, because God is love. So without out coming into deep encounter with you, not just on a basis that happened 20 years ago that we're living off an encounter, but on a daily basis, that we're seeking you and we're serving you and we're opening up our heart to you and we're saying, God, access whatever part of me that you want to. Do whatever you need to. Cut out whatever you need to cut out. Put whatever you need to put in. But grow me and spiritually mature. And God, I pray for every empty love tank right now, that Holy Spirit, you would breathe upon your people right now. You would breathe by the breath of God, that you would fill them with your Spirit right now, that they would be filled with the love of God, filled with the knowledge of God, filled right now with the joy of the Lord, that they would be revived, that they would be renewed, that they would be awakened right now. In the name which is above every name, let your love cover them. And as your love covers them, God, it's going to cover their family. And as that family is covered, it's going to cover that community. As that community is covered, it's going to cover this nation, God, because we have to return to you. We have to fall back in love with you, God. We have to fall in love with you. We can teach 10 ways to make it on a hot date, and 10 ways he said and she said, and this is what men do and this is what women does. But the bottom line is true love is spiritual. So if we don't go back to the source of love, God, we will always find ourselves lacking. Help us. Let us stop looking outside of ourselves, and let us give the gift that you gave us, the freedom for a person to be that individual and make whatever decision they want, and for us not to react to their decision, but to walk in love responsively and responsibly. I pray over every wounded heart right now. I pray over every person that's stuck. I pray right now that you would just unglue them. I Pray that you would just supernaturally flow. Just let the rivers of your word flow through them and wash over their soul right now in the name which is above every name. That you would take away the pain, the hurt, the things that have causing them to be restless and anxious and worrisome, depressed. Heal them, God. For you are Jehovah Rapha. And that means you're our emotional healer, not just our physical healer. Thank you for your healing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. So, Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, just thanking you, Father God, for, Lord God, your example of love through Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for just giving your life, Father God, for us that we can be, Father God, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your acts of love, for even while we were yet sinners, your word says that you died for us, oh God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for just the Holy Spirit, the comforter, the paracletos, the one that walks along aside us, Father, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, help us to yield to the voice of the Holy Spirit that will lead us in love, Father. We thank you, Father God, that we would, Father God, walk in love, that we would love as you have loved, Father God, that we would, Father God, love even our enemies, Father God, that we will yet pray for them, Father God. Lord Jesus, while Father God, you hung on the cross, Father God, you prayed for them, Father God, who crucified you. You told your Father, Father God, to forgive them, for they know not what they do, Father God. Let us have the same type of love. Let us have the same type of endurance. Let us have the same type of Holy Spirit-led life, Father God. Let us have the character of Christ in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord God, you said in your word, Father God, that even the publicans, Father God, will love those that love them, Father God, but we go a step beyond, Father God, where we can love those that do not love us, Father God. We can pray for them, Father God. We can believe the best for them, Father God, because we know, Father God, when we walk according to your will, Father God, you will have complete control, Father God. It seems absurd to man to pray for our enemies, Father God, but this is the will of God, Father God, because you have the final say. You have the last word right now in the name of Jesus. We pray that anything, Father God, that is causing our love walk to be stopped, let it be uprooted right now in the name of Jesus. Let it be cast out, Father God. Unforgiveness, childhood hurts and letdowns, Father God. Ways that we've been treated from our past, Father God. Let it be uprooted right now in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray, Father God. Lord, you said that when we walk in love, Father God, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, our faith will work, Father God. Even though we can have numerous gifts, Father God, and we don't have love, Father God, what is the meaning of it, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh God, so we just pray, Father God, that you help us to love the way Christ loved. Help us to give. Help us to serve. Help us to pray, Father God. Help us to speak a kind word, Father God. Help us to go by and visit, Father God. Help us to go beyond ourselves, Father God, even as you did, Father God. For this is the work and ministry of Christ, Father God. Love, Father God. You said that we will know that we are passed from death, from life, Father God, because we have love for the brethren, Father God. So we thank you right now for the love walk, Lord God. It's so easy to say I love you in this society, Father God, but let the actions and the spirit of Christ be behind it, Father God. Let it not be for gain, Father God, or hidden agendas, Father God, but let it be a righteous spirit behind it in the name of Jesus Christ, oh God. Let our words, Father God, the words and our actions, let it be pleasing, Father God, in your sight in the name of Jesus Christ, oh God. We ask you, oh God, to forgive us, Father God, when we did not love as you told us to. We ask you, oh God, to forgive us, Father God, when we did not forgive others, oh God. We ask you to forgive us, oh God, when we did not pray for others as you wanted us to, Father God. For this is, Father God, the heart of God, that we will always walk in love, Father God. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Father, we come, we give you the praise, the glory, and all the honor because you are worthy, Father, to be praised, Father God. Right now, I pray, Lord God, that you give us a hunger for your word again, Lord God. I pray, Father God, that you give us a hunger to return to our first love, Lord God. I pray, Father God, that we can get into your word and we begin to research your word. Father, I pray that we have the strength to let go of all the terminologies and doctrines and philosophies that we have about love and replace those who trust in the Word of God. Lord God, that we can walk out in love, how you define love, how you think of love, Lord God. Let us, glory to God, represent you well, Father God. Let us represent the kingdom of heaven here through love well, Lord God. I pray right now complete restoration for families out there, Lord God. I pray that husband and wives are going to turn back to each other, and they're going to want to serve each other, and they're going to want to help each other become what God wanted them to become, Lord God. I pray, Father, for a servant mentality right now, for a servant mindset right now, for a love revolution right now, Lord God. Lord, I pray, Father, that everybody, Father God, that is under the sound, Father, of my voice will start getting quickened by the Holy Spirit right now, Father, right now. Lord, I pray against all fear that might want us to keep us bound, Father, to offenses, and bound, Father God, to our boundaries, Lord God. I pray, Father God, that your love takes and just brings down all our walls, Father God. Let us not be afraid to love, and let us not be afraid to be loved by you, God, and by everyone around us, Father. Let us stop rejecting those that want to love us, Lord God. Let us stop rejecting love, and let us start embracing your love, God, and the love that you've put around us. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray, believe it, accept it, and receive it. Amen and amen.
Amen. Thank you, Victor. We love you guys. Thank you so much for joining us. If you would say, Paula, I just can't spiritually love because I don't have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that he's the Son of God, you'll be saved. Just pray this prayer with me. Say, Father, forgive me for all my sin. I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. If you prayed that prayer, I know it sounds crazy, but you're born again. You're saved. Now, there's a lot of work to do. He did the finished work on the cross. He did the majority of it. But now there's all this old stuff to get out and new stuff to put in. But behold, old things have passed away. All things have become a new creation or creature. And if you'd like to know more about that, go to paulawhite.org. There's a free digital download on what it means to be born again. Order the building blocks to faith. I'd love to pastor you. Thank you for being a part tonight. Let's say our benediction, okay? And let's pray for one another. If you got prayer requests, send them in to paulawhite.org. We pray. I mean, we really do pray. Ephesians 3:20 says, now unto him that's able to do exceeding abundantly above all we can ever ask or think according to his power that worketh in us. God bless you, and we'll see you Sunday morning at 10 a.m.